Welcome, dear friends, to this service for the fifth Sunday of Easter, and I'm very glad that you're able to join us this morning. A special word of welcome to all of you joining for us from outside of the parish. I'm aware of people in Pretoria, Johannesburg, in the Free State, and some dear friends at Hayes Nivelant in Claremont. I pray that you will all be truly blessed as we spend this time together worshipping God. Our birthdays that we remember in the parish this coming week, the 15th of May, Reese Pitchers, the 20th of May, Sheila Dewhurst and Aidan Naidu. We wish you all a blessed celebration of your birthday and that there would be many more to come. Anniversaries on the 18th of May, Rob and Kim Kay. Congratulations on your special day, and we also wish that there would be many more to come. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. The Lord be with you. Praise the Lord. Praise him, you servants of the Lord. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be his name, now and forever. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets." So let us confess our sins, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with our neighbor. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, in penitence we confess that we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, Christ our Lord, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on us. Pardon our sins and set us free from them. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Collect for the fifth Sunday of Easter. Let us pray. Gracious God, your Son revealed the meaning of love. Increase in us that same love, that all may know we are your disciples. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen.
The first reading comes from Acts 11, verses 1 to 18. Peter explains his actions. The apostles and the believers throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him and said, "You went into the house of uncircumcised men and ate with them?" Starting from the beginning, Peter told them the whole story. "I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision. I saw something like a large sheet being let down from heaven by its four corners, and it came down to where I was. I looked into it and saw four-footed animals of the earth, wild beasts, reptiles, and birds. Then I heard a voice telling me, 'Get up, Peter, kill and eat.' I replied, 'Surely not, Lord. Nothing impure or unclean has ever entered my mouth.' The voice spoke from heaven a second time, 'Do not call anything impure that God has made clean.' This happened three times, and then it was all pulled up to heaven again. Right then, three men who had been sent to me from Caesarea stopped at the house where I was staying. The Spirit told me to have no hesitation about going with them. These six brothers also went with me, and we entered the man's house. He told us how he had seen an angel appear in his house and say, 'Send to Joppa for Simon, who is called Peter. He will bring you a message through which you and all your household will be saved.' As I began to speak, the Holy Spirit came on them, as he had come on us at the beginning. Then I remembered what the Lord had said, 'John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' So if God gave them the same gift he gave us, who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I to think that I could stand in God's way?" When they heard this, they had no further objections and praised God, saying, "So then, even to Gentiles, God has granted repentance that leads to life." Hear the word of the Lord.
Psalm 148. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord from heaven. O praise him in the heights. Praise him, all his angels. O praise him, all his host. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you stars of light. Praise him, you highest heaven, and you waters that are above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded that they were made. He established them forever and ever. He made an ordinance which shall not pass away. O praise the Lord from the earth. Praise him, you sea monsters and all deeps. Fire and hail, mist and snow, and the windstorm fulfilling his command. Mountains and all hills, fruiting trees and all cedars, beasts of the wild and all cattle, creeping things and winged birds, kings of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the world, young men and maidens, old men and children together. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His glory is above the earth and heaven. And he has lifted high the horn of his people. Therefore he is the praise of all his servants, of the children of Israel, a people that is near him. Praise the Lord. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Today's reading comes from Revelation chapter 1, verses 1 to 6. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying of pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life." Hear the word of God.
The good news is proclaimed in the Gospel of John, chapter 13, beginning at verse 31. Glory to Christ our Saviour. After Judas had left, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man's glory is revealed. Now God's glory is revealed through him. And if God's glory is revealed through him, then God will reveal the glory of the Son of Man in himself, and he will do so at once. My children, I shall not be with you for very much longer. You will look for me, but I tell you now what I told the Jewish authorities. You cannot go where I am going. And now I give you a new commandment: love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. If you have love for one another, then everyone will know that you are my disciples." This is the Gospel of Christ. Praise to Christ our Lord.
In our readings for today, we see how God overcomes barriers that try to prevent the spread of the good news. God remains the guide and the driving force in this work that is being done through faithful disciples who are anointed by God. We see in some spectacular visions how God speaks to his people and reveals that everything that God has created is good and is to be cherished, and how love remains the catalyst for all God's work. We see this incredible barrier that is overcome when the Gentiles are included by God in his plan for the salvation of humankind, something that was initially thought of as absolutely impossible by the early Jewish Christians. There is this picture of total inclusivity and tolerance when it comes to being children of God, all motivated by that incredible love. The book of Acts has a central theme that can be described as the acts of God through God's Spirit, resulting in the worldwide spread of the good news through the power of the Holy Spirit. This book that is attributed to Luke is structured around the mission of those early disciples and converts, extending from Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and moving to the ends of the earth, which is described for us in Acts 1 verse 8. It describes for us the outworking of God's plan of salvation, linking the past to the present. This plan took shape in the new way of life that I've spoken about over these past 2 weeks. It's a new way of life based on the life, death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus that is now being continued and taught as the gospel is carried out into the world by believers and followers of Christ. Throughout Acts, we see the risen Christ always at work. He commissions the disciples and he pours out the Holy Spirit. We see miracles and signs being done in his name. We have looked at the incredible encounter with Saul on the road to Damascus, and many more stories which point us to the reality of God's plan of salvation for all of us. The story continues in our passage from Acts for today. Luke has been preparing the readers of Acts for the reality that God's salvation would extend to the Gentiles, as stated in Acts 1 verse 8. He does this through amazing stories of faithful disciples living their calling and ministry to the full. This is also reflected in the story of Cornelius. What makes the Cornelius episode in today's reading a notable intensification of this theme is the detail in its narration, the occurrence of multiple visions from the Lord, and the controversy that it sparks among the believers in Judea. It is actually a watershed moment in the expansion of the church's ministry and the shape of the community. Luke frames this episode and Peter's speech to focus our attention on contrasting understandings of who belongs in God's kingdom, and to show how the controversy created by these contrasting understandings is resolved among the early believers. Luke informs us in chapter 10 that Peter and the circumcised believers stayed with Cornelius and his family for several days. That concluding statement may strike us as rather insignificant, one that simply speaks to the newly expanded community that Luke often shows, resulting from the proclamation and acceptance of the gospel. But, if you really think about it, Israelites communing and actually staying with Gentiles, even those who have received the Holy Spirit, surely this is a bit much. That transgresses long-established boundaries that are seen as fundamental to the calling of God's people Israel. The Gentiles would be gifted with the Holy Spirit and thus be granted a place in God's plan for salvation. This was itself an astonishing development for these Israelite believers. But even more unfathomable to some was the notion that Israelites would share the table with Gentiles. This is simply unheard of at that time. Then we come to today's passage. News of Gentiles accepting the word of God reaches the believers in Judea. We would think this would be a cause for both amazement and celebration, but we are told that the Jewish believers criticized Peter. Peter responds by giving these people a very careful, deliberate reply, recounting step by step his vision from God and the events to follow. This, in turn, leads to the key point of his defense, which we read in verse 17. He said, "So if God gave them the same gift he gave us who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I to think that I could stand in God's way?" When Peter's critics hear this, Luke tells us, they were silenced. And then the celebration that we might have expected back in verse 1 erupts. We read, "When they heard this, they had no further objections and praised God, saying, 'So then, even to Gentiles, God has granted repentance that leads to life.'" It may strike us as odd that the circumcised believers, including Peter, who is by no means Lord, would invest so much importance in distancing themselves from Gentiles. But such purity norms reinforced for Israelites their identity as a people set apart to serve God, to honor God's Torah, and to receive God's deliverance. Purity codes for many Israelites, including these circumcised believers, emerged from and reinforced Israelite understandings of how creation, humanity, and daily life were to be ordered or mapped out. In short, purity is about things, objects, food, times, people, in their proper place as ordained by God. The concerns of the uncircumcised believers were not trivial legalisms. They reflected essential elements of their worldview that defined their role and place as the people of God. And so what we see depicted in this narrative at this watershed moment in the church's young history is repentance that leads to life, not only among Gentiles in Cornelius's household, but also among their circumcised fellow believers in Judea. We witness a miraculous change of heart, inspired by the Lord, that will now infuse the early believers with a radically transformed sense of the kind of community that is possible in God's new realm. This transformation, however, is far from complete, and we only have to look at the division that exists today. This radical transformation of these early believers is only possible because of what Jesus Christ achieved in his life, death, resurrection, and ascension. We are given a reminder today of what drives this incredible transformation in our gospel reading from John. The context of this passage in John is, of course, his account of Jesus' Last Supper with his disciples. Judas has left on his journey of betrayal, and it is dark outside. Jesus now speaks of his death as being glorified, which in itself is very strange. How can this death ever be a moment of glorification? Glory is an important theme in John's Gospel, as in all of Scripture. Glory refers to God's nature being revealed, and we see this happening throughout Scripture. But it is in the event of the crucifixion of Christ that the true nature of God is revealed to all of humankind. This is what God is like. This is a revelation of the extent and depth of his love for us. And this is the example that we are called to live in our lives. Just think about it. At this supper, Jesus knows that Peter, one of his closest companions, will deny him. Jesus knows how Judas is going to betray him. Jesus knows that his disciples will desert him when he is crucified. However, despite all of this, his parting words to his disciples focus not on blame for their past and future failures, but rather on preparing them for what is to come, promising that although he will no longer be physically present with them, they will not be abandoned. In the coming chapters in John, Jesus will talk about the Paraclete, the Advocate, the Helper, who will teach and advise and comfort them. Now he focuses on the need for his disciples to live in community and to love one another as he has loved them. This new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you, is in parallel with what Jesus has already told his disciples when he knelt to wash their feet. The new commandment is also paralleled in John chapter 15, where he says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you." These two parallels to our passage in John for today help to flesh out the meaning of loving one another. On the one hand, loving one another as Jesus has loved encompasses the mundane. It speaks of serving one another, even in the most menial of tasks. On the other hand, this love encompasses heroic acts of great risk. It extends even to the point of giving one's life for another. And we read of many instances where this has happened in history. So here in chapter 13, Jesus demonstrates his love for the same disciples who will fail him miserably. Jesus washes and feeds Judas, who will betray him, Peter, who will deny him, and all the rest who will fail to stand by him in his hour of greatest distress. The love that Jesus demonstrates is certainly not based on the merit of the recipients, and Jesus commands his disciples to love others in the same way. We who call ourselves disciples of Jesus or Christians have continually fallen short in our love for one another, as well as in our love for those outside the community of faith. Theological and ethical arguments often descend into personal attacks and name-calling. If someone doesn't share our point of view, then they are judged by us. Very often, personal interests are more important than the common good of the community. Sometimes, those most in need of compassion, caring, and love find judgment instead. Jesus could not be clearer in his message for us. It is not by our theological correctness, nor by our moral purity, nor by our impressive knowledge that everyone will know that we are his disciples. It is quite simply by our loving acts, acts of service and sacrifice, acts that point to the love of God for the world made known in Jesus Christ. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. Amen. Let us pray. Holy God, we come before you with thanksgiving for all your mercy and grace, and we give thanks for the beauty and wonder of the world around us, as we bring to you our prayers of intercession and thanksgiving. Almighty God, we pray today for your blessing to be upon your church throughout the world, for our diocese, for our archdeaconry, and for this parish. May your presence be seen vividly in all that we do and say each day. We pray that your joy and your love will flow freely in and through us, and that all that we do would bring honour and glory to your name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator God, St. John gave us a vision of a new heaven and a new earth. We pray for those parts of the world which badly need renewal. We pray for all countries experiencing war and oppression, and for countless number of people living in fear. Inspire and instruct our world leaders to constantly work for that day when all the world's peoples may enjoy security, peace, and a decent standard of living. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Faithful God, your Son Jesus said, "I give you a new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." In our worship today, we testify to God's love, shown perfectly in Christ, and we recommit ourselves to love one another as a community of faith. May your love be shown in the way that we live our lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, in your great mercy, comfort and relieve those who are sick, injured, aged, frail, or distressed, and according to their needs, enable them to draw strength from you and know that you are with them in all their troubles. In a time of silence, we bring before God those whom we know. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, we pray for those saddened by the death of a loved one, for members of our families who have died and whose anniversary we recall. Help us to draw comfort from the Holy Spirit and the fellowship of our church family. In a time of silence, we remember now before God those dear to us who have died. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. We come now to the celebration of the sacrament of the Holy Eucharist.
Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. For us it becomes the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. For us it becomes the cup of salvation. Blessed be God forever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Saviour and Redeemer. He is your living Word, through whom you have created all things. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh of the Virgin Mary and shared our human nature. He lived and died as one of us to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. In fulfillment of your will, he stretched out his hands in suffering to bring release to those who place their hope in you. And so he won for you a holy people. He chose to bear our griefs and sorrows and to give up his life on the cross, that he might shatter the chain of the evil one and banish the darkness of sin and death. By his resurrection, he brings us into the light of your presence. Now, with all creation, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious God, accept our praise through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who in the night he was handed over to suffering and death, took bread and gave you thanks, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is broken for you." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This is my blood, which is shed for you. When you do this, do it in memory of me." So we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection, we bring before you this bread and this cup, giving thanks that you have made us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit upon the offering of your Holy Church. Gather into one all who share in these sacred mysteries, filling them with the Holy Spirit and confirming their faith in the truth, that together we may praise you and give you glory through your servant, Jesus Christ. All glory and honour are yours, Father and Son, with the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Church, now and forever. Amen. As Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The bread which we break, is it not a sharing of the body of Christ? We, who are many, are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, give us your peace. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Draw near and receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Feed on him in your hearts by faith, with thanksgiving. The body of Christ. Amen. The blood of Christ. Amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is gracious. His mercy endures forever. Almighty and eternal God, we thank you for feeding us in these holy mysteries with the body and blood of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, and for keeping us by your grace in the body of your Son, the company of all faithful people. Help us to persevere as living members of that holy fellowship, and to grow in love and obedience according to your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Father Almighty, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice in Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out into the world in the power of the Holy Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. God bless Africa, protect our children, transform our leaders, heal our communities, restore our dignity, and give us peace, for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, remain with us always. Amen. So, dear friends, go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Christ, Lord, surely all. Thank you.